Are you ready to advocate for intellectual freedom? Ready to celebrate your right to read anything and everything your curiosity desires? All right. Before we jump in, I'd like to thank the amazing and dedicated Somerville Media Center for recording today's event for future broadcast, which is going to be on Thursday evenings in October from 8 p.m. to 11 p.m. And I'd like to thank the terrific cuisine and locale who donated veggie samosas to keep us sated during our celebration. I'd also like to thank the folks at City Hall who spread the word and made information about this event available on their website. Finally, and most importantly, I'd like to thank our hardworking, inspired librarians for bringing us all together today. Heidi, thank you for creating this opportunity and for inviting me to make an introduction. Mary, for creating ways to engage our patrons in the days leading up to this event, and for the baked goods that she shared today, and to Cassie for the powerful flyers and all of the promotion. Thank you. For years, Banned Books Week has been an annual event celebrating the freedom to read. Typically held during the last week of September, it highlights the value of free and open access to information. Banned Books Week brings together the entire book community. So that's librarians, booksellers, publishers, journalists, teachers, and readers of all types, in shared support of the freedom to seek and express ideas, even those that some consider unorthodox or unpopular. By focusing on efforts across the country to remove or restrict access to books, Banned Books Week draws national attention to the harms of censorship. The ALA Office for Intellectual Freedom compiles lists of challenged books as reported in the media and submitted by librarians and teachers across the country. The OIF estimates that more than half of all banned books are by authors of color. This year's highlighted list of books that were challenged between 2015 and 2016 represent just that and included Jeanette Winter's Nazarene Secret School, A True Story from Afghanistan. Challenged in the Duval County, Florida public schools in 2015 because a coalition of parents believes the book is inappropriate for promoting another religion that is not Christianity and is too violent for young children. Critics claim the book promotes the Quran and praying to Muhammad. Challenged at the Eau Claire, Wisconsin schools in 2015 because the book contains an Islamic prayer. The book is about the Taliban taking control of an Afghan village and preventing girls from going to school. After Nazreen's father is kidnapped and presumed killed, her grandmother smuggles her each day to an underground school where she can learn to read and write. A challenge is an attempt to remove or restrict materials based upon the objections of a person or group. A banning is the removal of those materials. Challenges do not simply involve a person expressing a point of view. Rather, they are an attempt to remove material from the curriculum or library, thereby restricting the access of others. As such, they are a threat to the freedom of speech and choice. The books featured during Banned Books Week have all been targeted with removal or restrictions in libraries and schools. While books have been continued to be banned, part of the Banned Books Week celebration is the fact that in a majority of cases, the books have remained available. This happens only thanks to the efforts of librarians, teachers, students, and community members who stand up and speak out for their freedom to read, which is what we are doing today. So take it from there, you guys. All right.
Thank you, Kathy, for giving an introduction. I'm going to read an excerpt from Where the Wild Things Are by Maurice Sendak. Max was sent to bed without supper, and people found this to be unacceptably cruel. He throws a tantrum, and it gives children nightmares. That's why it was challenged. All right, so Where the Wild Things Are. The night Max wore his wolf suit and made mischief of one kind and another. His mother called him Wild Thing, and Max said, "I'll eat you up." So he was sent to bed without eating anything. That very night in Max's room, Max's room of forest grew and grew and grew until the ceiling hung with vines and the walls became the world all around him. And an ocean tumbled by with a private boat for Max, and he sailed off through night and day, here to where the wild things are. And when he came to the place where the wild things are, they roared their terrible roars and gnashed their terrible teeth and rolled their terrible eyes and showed their terrible claws. Till Max said, "Be still," and tamed them with the magic trick.
I'll do the best I can. I don't know where the makeup person is. My name is Gene, and I'm going to read a book called Slaughterhouse-Five by Kurt Vonnegut. And apparently this was banned because it contains references to religious matters, explicit sexual scenes, violence, obscene language, bestiality, depictions of torture, ethnic slurs, negative portrayals of women, promotes deviant sexual behavior, and the sentence, the gun made a ripping sound like the opening of the fly of God Almighty. I can say that I remember reading this book either in high school or in college. Slaughterhouse-Five, if you're not familiar with the book, it's about the story of the bombing of Dresden at the end of World War II. Dresden was a German city that some people said had no military anyways, and over 100,000 people were killed in the firebombing. So in the story, Billy Pilgrim, who's the protagonist, if you will, is a prisoner of war in Germany at that time. It's in a bomb shelter. And I don't know if you've seen the movie. There's a movie made about this. The city is bombed, and when they come out of the bomb shelter, which was a slaughterhouse for animals, they find the city completely destroyed. So I'm just going to read two parts of this book. One is a foreword. It was written by an Englishman named David Irving. And this was a book published in the United States in 1964. And he says, "I find it difficult to understand Englishmen or Americans who weep about enemy civilians who were killed but who have not shed a tear for our gallant crews lost in combat with a cruel enemy," wrote his friend General Eaker in part. I think it would have been well for Mr. Irving to have remembered when he was drawing the frightful pictures of the civilians killed at Dresden, the V1s and V2s were at the very time falling on England, killing civilian men, women, children indiscriminately, as they were designed and launched to do. It might well be well to remember Buchenwald in Coventry too. I deeply regret that the British and U.S. bombers killed 135,000 people in the attack on Dresden. But I remember who started the last war, and I regret even more the loss of more than 5 million Allied lives and the necessary effort to completely defeat and utterly destroy Nazism. So I'll start at page 20, just read a few paragraphs. There was a Lufthansa plane that was supposed to fly from Philadelphia to Boston to Frankfurt. O'Hare was supposed to get on in Philadelphia, and I was supposed to get on in Boston, and off we'd go. But Boston was socked in, so the plane flew straight to Frankfurt from Philadelphia, and I became a non-person in the Boston fog. And Lufthansa put me in a limousine with some other non-persons and sent us to a motel for a non-night. The time would not pass, the wind-up kind, too. The second hand on my watch would twitch once, and a year would pass, and then it would twitch again. There was nothing I could do about it. As an earthling, I had to believe whatever clock said in calendars. I had two books with me, which I meant to read on the plane. One was Words for the Wind by Theodore Rottke, and this is what I found in there. I wake to sleep and take my waking slow. I feel my fate in what I cannot fear. I learn by going where I have to go. My other book was Erica Ostrowski's Sea Lion and His Vision. Sea Lion, Celine, I guess, was a brave French soldier in the First World War until his skull was cracked. After that, he couldn't sleep, and there were noises in his head. He became a doctor, and he treated poor people in the daytime, and he wrote grotesque novels all night. No art is possible without a dance with death, he wrote. The truth is death, he wrote. I fought nicely against it as long as I could, danced with it, festooned it, waltzed it around, and decorated with streamers, titillated it. Time obsessed him. Miss Ostrowski reminded me of the amazing scene of death on the installment plan, where Celine wants to stop the bustling of the street crowd. He screams on paper, make them stop, don't let them move anymore at all. There, make them freeze, once and for all, so that they won't disappear anymore. Just a personal note, one of the things I loved about this book was the fact that the author incorporated time travel for Billy Pilgrim. So you'll find circumstances where he travels back and forth between Dresden and his current life. So thank you very much for letting me speak.
Can you hear me? Okay.
Hi, my name is Glenn, and I'm going to read from a tractate of the Talmud called Brachot in Hebrew, which means blessings or benedictions. The Talmud is a ancient book. It dates back to approximately the 5th century. It's a compilation of, it's a unique work, in my opinion. It's a compilation of Jewish law, culture, history, philosophy, stories, lore, all rolled into one. And it also has a unique format. We have the text in the center followed by commentaries and super commentaries, and it's one of the main reasons I'm wearing glasses. This book has been banned, burned, and censored throughout its history, dating from approximately the Middle Ages to the present time. So I thought it was appropriate to read today. So I'm going to read from the very opening chapter of, which is actually the first tractate in the Talmud, of which there is a total of some 60-something odd tractates, some more odd than others, and which is read by some people in an annual, rather a seven-year cycle, one page a day for 7 years to complete the entire Talmud. And it's done throughout the world, actually. There are groups of people who study this every day, some who do it as part of the seven-year cycle, some of whom do it on their own, etc. Okay, so the opening, the chapter begins with the first Mishnah, and it goes as follows. I'm going to read it in the original Aramaic, and then I will translate as I go along. Me'emasai karin et shema ba'arvin. Now, right away, I have a question. I have a dispute with the nusach, with the wording of this, and I'm going to change the last word from ba'arvin to ba'arvi, so I'll explain what that means in a minute. So basically what it's asking is, when is the time for the recitation of the Shema benediction, which is the central prayer in Judaism, which is the, some of you may be familiar with it, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad, which is, Hear Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. It's a central prayer in Jewish liturgy, and basically the rabbis of the Talmud are asking, well, that Shema prayer is recited twice a day, once in the evening and once in the morning, in keeping with Jewish law, which posits that the day actually begins at sundown, because as it states in the book of Genesis, Vayihi Erev Vayihi Voker, it was night and it was day. So actually day begins at nightfall. So the rabbis are asking, when is the appropriate time to recite this the Shema benediction at night? And so the kvetch that I have with the wording of the last word is ba'arvin. I was taught that it was ba'arvit, and so there's different versions. So I'm just going to go with the one that I was taught. So I'm going to change the wording, as it were. So the first opinion is as follows: Mishaash haKahanim nichnasim leechol b'trumasim. That is from the time that the priest, the Kohanim in Hebrew, enter to eat their tithes. Okay, so priests, they didn't earn a salary like today's rabbis. Instead, they were they subsisted on the sacrificial offerings that people brought. There was a whole sacrificial cult, and animal sacrificial cult, as well as vegetable offerings, which was quite common back in ancient times. And so basically they were given a portion of those sacrificial offerings, which is called a tithe, and that's basically what they lived off of. And they ate these tithes at certain times of the day and at night in the temple. Ad sof ha'ashmura birishona, okay? And until the end of the first watch, okay? Which essentially means that there were lookouts placed in various parts or different places throughout the temple to look for the, to watch for the moon, to watch for the rays of the sun, because many of the prayers as well as the sacrifices were timed based on the location of the sun and the moon. Okay, so until from the time that the priests enter the to eat their truma until the first watch. Divrei Rabbi Eliezer, and this is the opinion of Rabbi Eliezer. The Chachamim Omrein Ad Chatzos. However, the sages disagree. And they say, They don't disagree with when you can begin to say the recite the Shema benediction. However, they argue with when until what time you can recite it. So instead of saying or agreeing with his statement that you have until the first watch, the rabbis, no, they give you longer. They say, no, we're going to give you until mid-afternoon. Sorry. Beginning of the afternoon. That's so it's literally afternoon. So everyone afternoon is, but it's, we're coming up upon it. So if you're a priestly background and you haven't finished eating your tithes and you haven't yet recited the Shema benediction, don't fret, don't worry. There's still time. We have approximately another half an hour. That's the opinion of the rabbis who argue with Rabbi Eliezer. Rabban Gamliel, not to be undone, states his own opinion. Rabban Gamliel, Omer, Ad Sha'ala Amar Shachar. And Gamliel says, no, it's actually from the, you have less time than you think. He disagrees with the rabbis. And he states that you have until the sighting of the first rays of the sun. So hence the people who are the watchmen who announce sprouting of the rays of the sun at the setting, but the illumination. According to Rabban Gamliel, that's you have only until that time. So his opinion is it's actually a little bit earlier. So now the Talmud illustrates this with a story. Illustrates Rabban Gamliel's rather opinion with a story, which it often does. Maisa, which introduces a story, Uba Ubanav Mibes Hamishta. One day, his sons came in from a, open to translation, some translated as a wedding. Some people say they were out for a night of drinking. And they came home, and it was late. And he said to them, this is kind of instructive into the relationship he had with his sons. He says to them, I'm Rulo. Lo krinu et shema. Sorry, they said to him, hey, Dad, we haven't yet recited the Shema benediction. So here they come home from a night of, I'm going to go with drinking. And the first thing they said to their father when they see him is, hey, Pops, we haven't done our religious duty yet. Maybe they're trying to score points with him, who knows. So Amar Lahem, he said back to them, Imlo ala amar shachar chayavin atem likrot. He said, if the rays of the sun haven't sprouted yet, you still have time. Maybe they didn't have windows in the house, I don't know. Didn't have a watch either. So you still have time. You still have, not only do you have time, but you're obligated to say it. Don't go to bed so fast. I know you're probably, you need to sleep off whatever you were doing, but if you haven't yet recited the Shema benediction yet shown, before you go to bed, you got this obligation you got to take care of. V'lozu bilvad, not only that, he said, Amru Ella, kol masha amru chachamim ad chatzos mitzvosen ad sha'alo amur shachar. He says, not only that, but if you're inclined, if any one of you is inclined to believe what read, that you have until afternoon, forget about it. Yeah, but only until the rays of the sprouting of the sun. I'm your father, okay? And you're gonna, this is my opinion, so don't think that you're gonna be leaning here and you know, take a shlof and go to sleep and sleep off, you're carousing because you still have until afternoon. Ain't happening. Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Ellen. I'm gonna read this book, Entangle Makes Three. This is one of the most banned children's books of all time, and you'll probably see why once I've read it. In the middle of New York City, there's a great big park we love to play there. It has a toy boat pond where they can sail their boats. It has a carousel to ride on in the summer and an ice rink to skate on in the winter. Best of all, it has its very own zoo. Every day, families of all kinds go to visit the animals that live there. But children and their parents aren't the only families at the zoo. The animals make families of their own. There are red panda bear families with mothers and fathers and furry red panda bear cubs. There are monkey dads and monkey moms raising noisy monkey babies. There are toad families and toucan families and cotton top tamarind families too. And in the penguin house, there are penguin families. Every year at the very same time, the girl penguins start noticing the boy penguins, and the boy penguins start noticing the girls. When the right girl and the right boy find each other, they become a couple. Two penguins in the penguin house were a little bit different. One was named Roy, and the other was named Silo. Roy and Silo were both boys, but they did everything together. They bowed to each other and walked together. They sang to each other and swam together. Wherever Roy went, Silo went too. They didn't spend much time with the girl penguins, and the girl penguins didn't spend much time with them. Instead, Roy and Silo wound their necks around each other. Their keeper, Mr. Gramsay, noticed the two penguins and thought to himself, they must be in love. Roy and Silo watched how the other penguins made a home. So they built a nest of stones for themselves. Every night, Roy and Silo slept there together, just like the other penguin couples. And every morning, Roy and Silo woke up together. But one day, Roy and Silo saw that the other couples could do something they could not. The mama penguin would lay an egg. She and the papa penguin would take turns keeping the egg warm until finally it would hatch. And then there would be a baby penguin. Roy and Silo had no egg to sit on and keep warm. They had no baby chick to feed and cuddle and love. Their nest was nice, but it was a little empty. One day, Roy found something that looked like what the other penguins were hatching, and he brought it to their nest. It was only a rock, but Silo carefully sat on it and sat and sat. And when Silo got sleepy, he slept. When Silo was done sleeping and sitting, he swam and Roy sat. Day after day, Silo and Roy sat on the rock, but nothing happened. Then Mr. Gramsay got an idea. He found an egg that needed to be cared for, and he brought it to Roy and Silo's nest. Roy and Silo knew just what to do. They moved the egg to the center of their nest. Every day they turned it so each side stayed warm. Some days Roy sat while Silo went for food. Other days it was Silo's turn to take care of their egg. They sat in the morning and they sat at night. They sat through lunchtime and swim time and supper. They sat at the beginning of the month, and they sat at the end of the month, and they sat all of the days in between. Until one day, they heard a sound coming from inside their egg. Peep, 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 it said. Royland silo called back. Squawk, squawk. Peep, peep, answered the egg. Suddenly, a tiny hole appeared in the egg's shell, and then... crack! Out came their very own baby. She had fuzzy white feathers and a funny black beak. Now, Roy and Silo were fathers. We'll call her Tango, Mr. Gramsay decided, because it takes two to make a tango. Roy and Silo taught Tango how to sing for them when she was hungry. They fed her food from their beaks. They snuggled her in their nest at night. Tango was the very first penguin in the zoo to have two daddies. Soon, Tango grew strong enough to leave the nest. Roy and Silo took her for a swim, just like all the other penguin families. And all the children who came to the zoo could see Tango and her two fathers playing in the penguin house with the other penguins. Hooray, Roy! Hooray, Silo! Welcome, Tango! They cheered. At night, the three penguins returned to their nest. There, they snuggled together, and like all the other penguins in the penguin house, and all the other animals in the zoo, and all the families in the big city around them, they went to sleep.
Here are the real Roy and Silo and Tango. So, the book was banned because of people don't like the depiction of homosexuality. And Somerville, I'm not aware that we've had banned and challenged books. We love our gay penguins.
Can I get some noise up in here? Woo! Thank you all for having me here today. So, banned books celebrating literature that is deemed unacceptable by most likely committees of people who feel strongly that depictions of certain concepts or feelings or imagery is not allowed to be seen or viewed or heard in schools, libraries, right? Here I have Where's Waldo? Banned book. Who knew? One of my favorite. I love this whole series. I thought it was spectacular. And apparently, Where's Waldo by Martin Hanford has been banned. And this book has been challenged because a handful of people say that the otherwise innocent images, illustrations, contain, quote, inappropriate and seditious hidden imagery, end quote. including topless sunbathers, gay lovers, and characters holding up the rocker hand sign. Like, that's not allowed? That's so interesting. Who knew? And another fun fact is that this series is published here in Somerville, Massachusetts by Candlewick. So shout out to a local publisher. Yeah. Yeah. So buy local, support local, and keep reading Where's Waldo. That's it. I mean, it's really hard to read. We could do a like an interactive like search. Can you find Where's Waldo? Where's the nude sunbather? Where's the sun? I mean, I see a lot of like, you know, nude male tops. I mean, probably, I guess, by society standards. A lot of people who are severely sunburned. I'm offended by that. Like, where was your sunscreen? Where was the SPF? Right. I mean, it looks like Waldo's actually hanging out over here by this family who's holding up their baby. And it's kind of, they're in like a fenced-in area. So it looks like actually Waldo is participating in more than just, like, being lost. He's fully clothed. Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, the way that this, like, beach, like, I don't know, Waldo's looking awfully suspicious. But I don't see any of the hand rock gestures as the as this reading says right here. Yeah, maybe. So, yeah. Support local. Free range. Where's Waldo? Candlestick?
This is a reprise. I read this last year for this event, and it's so good. I can't help myself. I just have to do it again. This book, of course, is the famous, infamous book by the famous reclusive author, J.D. Salinger. Is he still alive? I think he passed away recently. But I don't know that for a fact. J.D., are you in there? J.D., can you hear me? Wait, hold on. I'm getting a call right now. He says, leave me the fuck alone. Okay. Ban this librarian. Okay, so why has this book been banned? Why has this book been challenged? According to this slip of paper from an unknown source, it states, quote unquote, it is anti-white. Anti-white what? I don't know, but anti-white. And it's quote unquote obscene. And further additional quotes, unacceptable, and obscene again. It's twice obscene. It is like really frickin' obscene. It contains profanities, no shit, and it depicts premarital sex. Not postmarital sex, but premarital sex. Oh, in addition, alcohol abuse and prostitution. It's been challenged in the Waterloo, Iowa schools. With a name like that, what do you expect? I didn't say that. And Duval County, Florida public school libraries in 1992 because of profanity, lurid passages, my all-time favorite, about sex, and statements defamatory to minorities, God, women, and the disabled. Holy cow. Some little something for everybody. Interestingly enough, the book is inscribed to my mother. And by that, I assume he means his mother, not mine, but you never know. I think they were born in the same year, so it's possible that he knew her. So, I'm going to read from the opening paragraph, which is one of my favorite paragraphs from one of my favorite books. And it goes as follows. If you really want to hear about it, the first thing you'll probably want to know is where I was born and what my lousy childhood was like. Can we all relate? And how my parents were occupied and all before they had me and all that David Copperfield kind of crap. But I don't feel like going into it, if you want to know the truth. In the first place, that stuff bores me. And in the second place, my parents would have about 2 hemorrhages apiece if I told anything pretty personal about them. Can we relate? They're quite touchy about anything like that, especially my father. They're nice and all, I'm not saying that, but they're also touchy as hell. Besides, I'm not going to tell you my whole goddamn autobiography or anything. I'll just tell you about this madman stuff that happened to me around last Christmas just before I got pretty run down and had to come out here and take it easy. I mean, that's all I told DB about, and he's my brother and all. He's in Hollywood. This isn't too far from this crummy place. He comes over and visits me practically every week, and he's going to drive me home when I get home next month, when I go home next month, maybe. He just got a Jaguar. Jaguar? That's how the British pronounce it. We say Jaguar. One of those little English jobs that can do around 200 miles an hour. It cost him damn near $4,000. He's got a lot of dough now. He didn't used to. He used to be just a regular writer when he was home. He wrote this terrific book of short stories, The Secret Goldfish. Have any of you read it? In case you never heard of him, I wonder what the goldfish's secret is. Maybe it's a gay goldfish. I don't know. The best one in it is The Secret Goldfish. It's about this little kid that wouldn't let anybody look at his goldfish because he bought it with his own money. It killed me. Now he's out in Hollywood, DB being a prostitute. If there's one thing I hate, it's the movies. Don't even mention them to me.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Oh, here, that's right. Well, oh, at 1, okay. Because I think it's supposed to stop raining around 4, so I don't know if they'll delay it or not. But. Okay, so back a couple of weeks ago, I went on vacation, Berkshires, and part of it was that we took a trip into Manhattan for a day to go see Michael Moore because he's doing a one-man show at the Velasco Theater. And so for those of you who don't know Michael Moore, is a documentary filmmaker. He's had nonfiction TV show back in the 90s, The Ugly Truth. He is very political, a good advocate, like the water crisis in Flint, Michigan. You know, he was very vocal about that and kept trying to keep that on the forefront of the news. And he's also hilarious. He's a funny, funny guy. So my husband and I are big fans of his, and we were looking forward to going. And so the theme for his one-man show is that every one person can make a difference. And it doesn't matter who you are or how old you are, and sometimes it happens in for him, he had these great experiences where he wasn't intending on making a difference, and then it just happened. And he realized the power of that, and it kind of made him keep doing what he was doing. So he started to tell the story about his book, Stupid White Men, which came out, it was supposed to come out on September 11, 2001. And so there were about 50,000 copies of the book ready to go. It had already, so written, published, like printed, it was ready to go, September 10th. And then when 9/11 happened, HarperCollins called. And so I wish so much that, like, I had video of this moment because the way he told it was just so amazing. But instead, what I did was I found an article that, this is from 2002, so July of 2002. And so some of the language in it is hilariously dated because cyberspace is in it. But the story, I'm just going to read it. It's a great story. Michael Moore attributes the publication of his latest best-selling book, Stupid White Men and Other Excuses for the State of the Nation, to the efforts of a lone librarian. On September 10th, HarperCollins printed the first 50,000 copies ready to be shipped. By the end of the following evening, the publishing house decided it would be disastrous to distribute a book containing an open letter to President Bush, asking him if he was ever a drunk, felon, or illiterate. Even I'm two out of those three. HarperCollins was in no hurry to publish a book that surfed that surfed against the patriotic waves sweeping across the country. We'd like you to rewrite 50% of it, they told Moore. And actually, when I saw him do this live, he had a copy of the manuscript that was, 50% of it was blacked out, basically. And he just, held it up to the audience. They told him that Florida cannot be called a coup, and they requested the chapter Kill Whitey to be reworded. When they asked Moore to change the title, he suggested, bring me the head of Antonia Scalia as an alternative. They informed him that they would reprint the first 50,000 copies for the low, low fee of $10,000. Moore was not about to cut one word from the book. Tired of Moore's resistance to censor himself, his editor called to tell him that his book was going to be pulped. On December 1st, pulped, they were just going to destroy all the copies of it. On December 1st, Moore found himself giving a presentation in New Brunswick, New Jersey. He told the audience about his struggle to get his book published and that the only copies in existence were about to be recycled and probably would come back as Rush Limbaugh or Bill O'Reilly books. Moore read the first chapters of his book to the group. You're probably the only people in America who will ever hear these words, he said. He asked the people in the room that day not to go to press and make a fuss over it. It was his battle, and he was determined to fight it alone, away from the public eye. Somewhere in the audience that day was Anne Sparisi, a librarian from Englewood, New Jersey. She did not heed his warning about going public. Like a cyberspace Paul Revere, Sparisi sent word to various email lists, including SRRT, Social Responsibilities Roundtable, and Library Juice, explaining Moore's situation. She conveyed this battle wasn't just one man's struggle with the publishing house, but was a battle to preserve free speech and to stop censorship. 2 days later, HarperCollins phoned Moore. "What did you tell the librarians?" they asked. "We're getting hundreds of letters a day from angry librarians. Do you know how much business we do with these people?" Right? Right. HarperCollins eventually gave stupid white men the green light, but not before informing Mr. Moore, "You are out of touch with the American people." They handed him the list of cities for the book tour. There were only three listed: Ridgewood, New Jersey, Arlington, Virginia, and Denver, Colorado. The message was clear to him. HarperCollins wanted no association with this book. Moore was on his own. On the first day of its release, all 50,000 copies were sold. The next day, it was the number one seller on Amazon.com. By the fifth day, the book was in its ninth printing. As of today, it is in the 22nd printing, so that was back in 2002, and is selling faster than the latest works from Grisham and Clancy combined. The end.
All right. My name is Dave. All right. The Tucson Unified School District launched its Mexican American Studies program in 1998, but in the last decade, this initiative faced an uphill battle. I'm reading this off of the Remescla website, by the way. As the fate of ethnic studies in Arizona once again rests in the hands of the judicial system, there are nearly 90 books and textbooks that the TUSD students aren't allowed to read in class. In 2010, the state of Arizona passed House Bill 2281, a law banning ethnic studies. The statute made it illegal to teach classes that, quote, promote the overthrow of the United States government, promote resentment toward a race or class of people, are designed primarily for pupils of a particular ethnic group, or advocate ethnic solidarity instead of the treatment of pupils. 2 years later, after an administrative law judge ruled that the program violated a state law, the governing board of the Tucson Unified suspended the Mexican American Studies program. School officials confiscated books, effectively shutting down a program that is especially beneficial to students of color. According to a Stanford University study released in 2016, students enrolled in ethnic studies miss fewer days of school, get better grades, and even graduate at higher rates. This is especially true for Latino and male students. So one of the books that was part of that program that was banned is The Devil's Highway by Luis Alberto Urrea. And just a quick summary of that book. As immigration remains a contentious issue, The Devil's Highway, published nearly 15 years ago, is still a must-read. The story follows a group of 26 men who in May 2001 resorted to extremely risky path down the Devil's Highway, a stretch of land that is so harsh that even the Border Patrol won't travel through it to reach the United States. Only 12 made it to the other side. So this is an excerpt from that book. 5 men stumbled out of the mountain pass, so sunstruck they didn't even know their own names, couldn't remember where they'd come from, had forgotten how long they'd been lost. One of them wandered back up a peak. One of them was barefoot. They were burned nearly black, their lips huge and cracking. What paltry drool still available to them, spurting from their mouths in a salty foam as they walked. Their eyes were cloudy with dust, almost too dry to blink up a tear. Their hair was hard and stiffened by old sweat, standing in crowns from their scalps, old sweat because their bodies were no longer sweating. They were drunk from having their brains baked in the pan. They were seeing God and devils, and they were dizzy from drinking their own urine, the poison clogging their systems. They were beyond rational thought. Visions of home fluttered through their minds, soft green bushes, waterfalls, children, music. Butterflies the size of your hand, leaves and beans of coffee plants burning through the morning mists as if lit from within. Rivers. Not like this place where they'd gotten lost, nothing soft here, this world of spikes and crags was as alien to them as if they'd suddenly awakened on Mars. They'd seen cowboys cut open cacti to find water in movies, but they didn't know what cactus among the many before them might hold some hope. Men tore their faces open, chewing cigarros and prickly pears, leaving gutted plants that looked like animals had torn them apart with their claws. The green here was gray. They were walking now for water, not salvation, just a drink. They whispered it to each other as they staggered into parched pools of their own shadows, forever spilling downhill before them. Just one drink, brothers, water, cold water. They walked west, though they didn't know it. They had no concept anymore of destination. The only direction they could manage was through the gap they stumbled across as they cut through the granite mountains of southern Arizona. Now canyons and arroyos shuffled them west toward Yuma, though they didn't know where Yuma was and wouldn't have reached it if they did. They came down out of the screaming sun and broke into the rough plains of the Cabeza Prieta wilderness at the south end of the United States Air Force Barry Goldwater bombing range, where the sun recommenced its burning. Cutting through this region and lending its name to the terrible landscape was the Devil's Highway, more death, another desert. They were in a vast trickery of sand. In many ancient religious texts, fallen angels were bound in chains and buried beneath. This could be the place. In the distance, deceptive stands of mesquite trees must have looked like oases. 10 trees a quarter mile apart can look like a cool grove from a distance. In the western desert, 20 miles looks like 10, and 10 miles can kill. There was still no water. There wasn't even any shade.
Can I have some more cowbell? Okay. All right. I'm sorry, what? What am I doing? Okay. I'm Ellen again, and I'm going to read from J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, a highly banned series of books. Banned on the grounds that it glamorizes witchcraft, and there's some, I think, mainly Christian folks that are not down with that. It's Dudley's birthday, and they all go to the zoo for a treat. Harry's not supposed to be there, but the babysitting thing fell through, so he's being dragged along to the delight of no one. After lunch, they went to the reptile house. It was cool and dark in there, with lit windows all along the walls. Behind the glass, all sorts of lizards and snakes were crawling and slithering over bits of wood and stone. Dudley and Piers wanted to see huge, poisonous cobras and thick, man-crushing pythons. Dudley quickly found the largest snake in the place. It could have wrapped its body twice around Uncle Vernon's car and crushed it into a trash can, but at the moment it didn't look like it was in the mood. In fact, it was asleep. Dudley stood with his nose pressed against the glass, staring at the glistening brown coils. "Make it move," he whined at his father. Uncle Vernon tapped on the glass, but the snake didn't budge. "Do it again," Dudley ordered. Uncle Vernon rapped the glass smartly with his knuckles, but the snake just snoozed on. "This is boring," Dudley moaned. He shuffled away. Harry moved in front of the tank and looked intently at the snake. He wouldn't have been surprised if it had died of boredom itself. No company except stupid people drumming their fingers on the glass, trying to disturb it all day long. It was worse than having a cupboard as a bedroom, where the only visitor was Aunt Petunia hammering on the door to wake you up. At least he got to visit the rest of the house. The snake suddenly opened its beady eyes. Slowly, very slowly, it raised its head until its eyes were on a level with Harry's. It winked. Harry stared. Then he looked quickly around to see if anyone was watching. They weren't. He looked back at the snake and winked, too. The snake jerked its head toward Uncle Vernon and Dudley, then raised its eyes to the ceiling. gave Harry a look that said quite plainly, "I get that all the time." "I know," Harry murmured through the glass, though he wasn't sure the snake could hear him. "It must be really annoying." The snake nodded vigorously. "Where do you come from anyway?" Harry asked. The snake jabbed its tail at a little sign next to the glass. Harry peered at it. "Boa constrictor, Brazil." "Was it nice there?" The boa constrictor jabbed its tail at the sign again, and Harry read on. "This specimen was bred in the zoo." "Oh, I see. So you've never been to Brazil." As the snake shook its head, a deafening shout behind Harry made them both jump. "Dudley! Mr. Dursley! Come and look at the snake! You won't believe what it's doing!" Dudley came waddling toward them as fast as he could. "Out of the way, you!" he said, punching Harry in the ribs. Caught by surprise, Harry fell hard on the concrete floor. What came next happened so fast, no one saw how it happened. One second, Piers and Dudley were leaning right up close to the glass. The next, they had leaped back with howls of horror. Harry sat up and gasped. The glass front of the boa constrictor's tank had vanished. The great snake was uncoiling itself rapidly, slithering out onto the floor. People throughout the reptile house screamed and started running. As the snake slid swiftly past him, Harry could have sworn a low, hissing voice said, "Brazil, here I come. Thanks, amigo." The keeper of the reptile house was in shock. "But the glass," he kept saying, "where did the glass go?" The zoo director himself made Aunt Petunia a cup of strong, sweet tea while he apologized over and over again. Piers and Dudley could only gibber. As far as Harry had seen, the snake hadn't done anything except snap playfully at their heels as it passed. But by the time they were all back in Uncle Vernon's car, Dudley was telling them how it had nearly bitten off his leg, while Piers was swearing it had tried to squeeze him to death. But worst of all, for Harry at least, was Piers calming down enough to say, "Harry was talking to it, weren't you, Harry?" Piers was safely out of the house before starting on Harry. He was so angry he could hardly speak. He managed to say, "Go, cupboard, stay, no meals," before he collapsed into a chair, and Aunt Petunia had to run and get him a large break.